1 of 1977. The accused was charged with the following offences: A, conspiracy to commit the offences of kidnapping, robbery with aggravating circumstances, and murder, brackets, count one. B, kidnapping, two. C, robbery with aggravating circumstances, count three. D, murder, count four. And E, obstructing the administration of justice, count five. In count one, it was specifically alleged that the accused conspired with Zola Tongo, Mzwe Madoda Kwabe, and Zolele Mngene to commit the alleged offences, quote, by entering into an agreement with Tongo in terms of which Tongo would procure the services of a person or persons to do one or more or all of the following. First subparagraph, simulate a hijacking of Tongo's motor vehicle. Next subparagraph, simulating a kidnapping and robbery of Tongo and the accused, and or next subparagraph, effect the kidnapping, robbery, and murder of the deceased Anni Dewani. And in that, according to the conspiracy agreement, the accused would provide payment to the perpetrators as well as to Tongo for the kidnapping, robbery, and murder of the deceased Anni Dewani, end quote. Counts 2 to 4 contain the allegation that Tongo, Kwabe, and Mngeni acted in furtherance of a common purpose to kidnap the deceased, rob the deceased, and kill the deceased. The other accomplice, Monde Mulombo, was not charged as a co-conspirator. It follows that it is therefore crucial for the state case to prove that the accused entered into an alleged conspiracy agreement with Tongo. Failing such proof, the accused cannot be convicted of any of the first four counts, and accordingly also not on the fifth. The legal position. Section 174 of the Criminal Procedure Act provides, quote, if at the close of the case for the prosecution at any trial, the court is of the opinion that there is no evidence that the accused committed the offence referred to in the charge or any offence of which he may be convicted on the charge, it may return a verdict of not guilty. It is well established that no evidence, put that in quotes, does not mean no evidence at all, but rather no evidence on which a reasonable court, acting carefully, might convict. The question whether a court should grant a discharge at this stage is one which entails a discretion by the trial court. It is a discretion which must, self-evidently, be exercised judicially. The judicial pronouncements on the manner in which the trial court must exercise its discretion have over the years been contentious. I do not intend to give a full historical overview and will confine myself to a brief reference to those cases that help define the scope of this court's discretion in terms of Section 174. In State versus Schuping, S-H-U-P-I-N-G and others, Supra, Heemstra CJ reviewed the case law history of discharge applications and formulated the test as follows at 120 in fine to 121. Quote, at the close of the state case, when discharge is considered, the first question is, first subparagraph, is there evidence on which a reasonable man might convict? If not, next subparagraph, is there a reasonable possibility that the defense evidence might supplement the state case? If the answer to either question is yes, there should be no discharge and the accused should be placed on his defense. The second part of the latter test did not always find favor. In State versus Puravata and others, 1992-2, South African Criminal Law Reports 544, V. Du Toit AJ stated the following, quote, The presumption in favour of innocence, the fact that the onus rests on the state, as well as the dictates of justice, in my view, will normally require an exercise of the discretion under Section 174 in favour of an accused person where the state case is virtually and basically non-existent. Strengthening or supplementation of a non-existent state case is a physical impossibility, end quote. Since the inception of our constitutional order, conflicting views arose as to whether or not the Constitution has impacted on the test to be applied by a court in an application in terms of Section 174. These decisions culminated in the Supreme Court of Appeal finally deciding the issue in State versus Leboxa, 2001, brackets 2, South African Criminal Law Reports, 703 SCA, inter alia as follows. Quote, paragraph 18, I have no doubt that an accused person, brackets, whether or not he is represented, close brackets, is entitled to be discharged at the close of the case for the prosecution if there is no possibility of a conviction other than if he enters the witness box and incriminates himself. The failure to discharge an accused in those circumstances, if necessary mere motu, is in my view a breach of the rights that are guaranteed by the Constitution and ordinarily vitiate a conviction based exclusively on his self-incriminatory evidence. The right to be discharged at this stage of the trial does not necessarily arise, in my view, from considerations relating to the burden of proof, brackets, or its concomitant, the presumption of innocence, close brackets, or the right of silence, or the right to testify, but arguably from a consideration which is of more general application. Clearly, a person ought not to be prosecuted in the absence of a minimum of evidence upon which he might be convicted, merely in the expectation that at some stage he might incriminate himself. That is recognized by the common law principle that there should be, quote within a quote, reasonable and probable, end quote, cause to believe that the accused is guilty of an offense before a prosecution is initiated. And the constitutional protection afforded to dignity and personal freedom, in brackets section 10 and section 12, close brackets, seem to reinforce it. It ought to follow that if a prosecution is not to be commenced without that minimum of evidence, so too should it cease when the evidence finally falls below that threshold. That will preeminently be so where the prosecution has exhausted the evidence and a conviction is no longer possible except by self-incrimination. A fair trial, in my view, would at that stage be stopped, for it threatens thereafter to infringe our constitutional rights protected by Section 10 and Section 12. It has been held that the credibility of state witnesses at this stage of the proceedings only plays a very limited role. In State of versus Mpeta, Williamson J. held that the relevant evidence can only be ignored if, quote, it is of such poor quality that no reasonable person could possibly accept it, end quote. This sentiment was also echoed and expanded on by Hormoday J. in State versus Agliotti, 2011, brackets 2, South African Criminal Law Reports, 437, GSJ, who stated the following at 456 in fine, 2457B. Quote, 272, in State versus Lavengwa, 1996, brackets 2, South African Criminal Law Reports, 456W, the view was expressed that the processes under 174 translate into a statutorily granted capacity to depart discretionally in certain specific and limited circumstances from the usual course to cut off the tail of a superfluous process. Such a capacity does not detract from either the right to silence or the protection against self-incrimination. If an acquittal flows at the end of the state case, the opportunity or need to present evidence by the defense falls away. If the discharge is refused, the accused still has the choice whether to testify or not. There is no obligation on him to testify. Once this court rules that there is no prima facie case against the accused, there also cannot be any negative consequences as a result of the accused's silence in this context. 273, I agree with the view that it is an exercise in futility to lay down rigid rules in advance for an infinite variety of factual situations which may or may not arise. It is thus, in my view, also, quote within a quote, unwise to attempt to banish issues of credibility, end quote, in the assessment of issues in terms of Section 174, or to confine judicial discretion to musts and must nots, end quote. To therefore summarize the legal position in terms of Section 174, it follows that first subparagraph, an accused is entitled to be discharged at the end of the case for the prosecution if there is no possibility of a conviction other than if he enters the witness box and incriminates himself. B, in deciding whether an accused person is entitled to be discharged at the close of the state case, the court may take into account the credibility of the state witnesses, even if only to a limited extent. Where the evidence, that's the next subparagraph, of the state witnesses implicating the accused is of such poor quality that it cannot safely be relied upon, and there is accordingly no credible evidence on record upon which a court, acting carefully, may convict, an application for discharge should be granted. It is common cause that the only witness who could implicate the accused was Tongo, who was an accomplice witness. It is trite that a court should approach the evidence of an accomplice witness with caution. The duty of a court in this regard has been described as follows in Rex versus Nkunana, 1948, 4 SA, 399 AD at 405. Quote, the cautious court or jury will often properly acquit in the absence of other evidence connecting the accused with the crime, but no rule of law or practice requires it to do so. What is required is that the trier of fact should warn himself, or, if the trier of fact is a jury, that it should be warned of the special danger of convicting on the evidence of an accomplice. For an accomplice is not merely a witness with a possible motive to tell lies about an innocent accused, but is such a witness peculiarly equipped by reason of his inside knowledge of the crime to convince the unwary that his lies are the truth. This special danger is not met by corroboration of an accomplice in material respects not implicating the accused, or by proof aliunde that the crime charged with was committed by someone. The risk that he will be convicted will be reduced, and in the most satisfactory way, if there is corroboration implicating the accused, end quote. In State versus Mahlabati and another, 1968, 2, SA 48A, at page 50G to 51A, Potgieter J.A. dealt with this question as follows. It is clear from the authorities, if corroboration was required, it had, for the purpose of the so-called cautionary rule, to be corroboration implicating the accused and not merely corroboration in a material respect or respects. Potgieter also confirmed the views of Schreiner J.A. in the Nkanana case. In State v. Gentle, 2005-1, South African Criminal Law Reports 420, SCA at 430, Clutie JA, in dealing with the approach to be followed by a court when it is faced with a situation where a court should caution itself in analyzing the evidence, said the following, quote, "It must be emphasized immediately that by corroboration is meant other evidence which supports the evidence of the complainant and which renders the evidence of the accused less probable on the issues in dispute." In State v. Scott Crosley, 2008-1, South African Criminal Law Reports 223, SCA at 234, the court stressed that, quote, "Matters which are common cause between the state and the accused cannot provide corroboration for matters in dispute. Otherwise, for example, the fact that an accused in a rape case confirmed that he had sexual intercourse with a complainant could be taken as corroboration of the latter's version that he had done so with consent, which is plainly absurd. From the foregoing, it follows that the images in the CCTV footage, to which I will refer in more detail later, depicting A, the accused meeting Tongo in the parking lot of the Cape Grace Hotel on Friday the 12th of November 2020, B, the accused being picked up by Tongo on Saturday morning 30 November 2010 at the Cape Grace Hotel, C, the accused being dropped off again by Tongo later on that Saturday morning at the Cape Grace Hotel, D, the accused and the deceased being picked up by Tongo on the Saturday evening at the Cape Grace Hotel, E, the accused talking to Tongo after the incident on Sunday the 14th of November 2010, and F, the accused paying Tongo R1,000 in the communication room on Tuesday the 16th of November, do not provide corroboration for the version of Tongo where it differs from that of the accused in his plea explanation, as these events were not in issue between the state and the defense. It is what was said during those events that is in issue, and for that there is only the version of Tongo. The same applies to the telephone communication between the accused and Tongo, between Tongo and Malombo, and Kwabe. This telephone communication does not in itself corroborate what was said during those calls. It merely confirms that the communication took place. Against the background of these legal principles, I will now proceed to analyze the evidence. Zola Tongo. At the outset, it needs to be repeated that Mr. Tongo is the only witness who testified that the alleged conspiracy agreement was entered into with the accused and what the terms of the agreement were. It is clear that Mr. Tongo, Mr. Kwabe, and Mr. Mgeni, and in brackets, and Mr. Malombo, close brackets, acted in execution of a common purpose to commit at least the offenses of kidnapping and robbery, and possibly also other offenses. The only issue which I have to determine is whether the evidence shows that the accused was part of that conspiracy. Evidence in chief. Mr. Tongo testified that he was an executive taxi driver on the day in question, namely the 12th of November 2010, and that he was at Cape Town International Airport waiting for fares. He stated that the accused approached him and asked him where he could find transport to town. Mr. Tongo responded that he could transport him to town, and although there was a taxi rank to which he directed the accused, he told the accused that those taxis were generally more expensive. The accused informed him that he wanted to go to the Cape Grace Hotel and informed Mr. Tongo that he was not alone and that his wife was with him. Mr. Tongo testified that while he was waiting, he saw, in inverted commas, lady, come from the inside of the airport towards him. It is common cause that this woman was the deceased. Mr. Tongo's car was parked on the lower level of the parking garage. On their way to the parking garage, the deceased asked him why he was not parked where the other taxis were parked. He told her that he did not yet have a permit to park there. He testified that during the drive from the airport to the Cape Grace Hotel, he did all he could to market himself and his services to the couple. It is common cause that Mr. Tongo was driving the Volkswagen Chiron in which the deceased's body was found. On the way to the Cape Grace Hotel, Mr. Tongo told the couple about Cape Town's beauty, about the squatter camps, and the importance of the township of Guguletu, which is right next to the squatter camps. He told them about the well-known tavern Kwa Mzoli in Guguletu. He told them about other tourist attractions, such as the penguins at Boulders Beach. Mr. Tongo was hoping that the Dewanis would use his services while they were in Cape Town. Mr. Tongo testified that en route there was very little interaction between the couple and himself. Upon their arrival at the Cape Grace Hotel, the deceased accompanied a porter with their luggage to the reception area while the accused remained behind at the car in order to pay Mr. Tongo his fare. At that stage, Mr. Tongo gave him one of his business cards. The accused then informed him that he has a job for him and that he must wait for him in the parking area of the hotel. Mr. Tongo went to park his car in the parking area and waited. The accused then went inside the hotel to check in and after a while returned and got into Mr. Tongo's vehicle. The accused then informed him that the job that he had for Mr. Tongo would make his business grow because he, the accused, was from overseas and can refer other travelers to him who in turn would refer further travelers to him. Shortly thereafter, the accused told him that the real job that he, the accused, had for Mr. Tongo was that he wanted somebody, quote, removed from the eyes, end quote. When Mr. Tongo asked him to explain what he meant, he stated that he wanted somebody to be killed. Mr. Tongo told the accused that he was not involved in such things, but informed him that he knew somebody who lives in the location who might know about people who would be prepared to do it. According to Mr. Tongo, he was at all times informed by the accused that it was his, quote, business partner, end quote, who would be arriving the following day that he wanted killed. Mr. Tongo knew that the person to be killed was a woman. Mr. Tongo and the accused parted company on the basis that if Mr. Tongo should find somebody who would be prepared to do the job, he would contact the accused and inform him accordingly. The two gentlemen exchanged phone numbers. They also discussed the remuneration that would be paid for the job, and the accused explained that he would be prepared to pay 15,000 rand when the job was done. Over and above the 15,000 rand, Mr. Tongo would receive an amount of 5,000 rand. The accused also stated that he had dollars and could pay in dollars. Mr. Tongo thereafter left and immediately went to Century City to the Protea Coliseum Hotel, where he met his friend, Mr. Monde Mbolombo, who worked as a receptionist at the hotel. Mr. Tongo explained that the reason why he approached Mr. Mbolombo was because Mr. Mbolombo lives in the location and he, quote, knows everything that happens in the location. Put a few dots. Still part of the quote, I realize that there must be things that he is aware of, comma, things that are happening in the locations, things that I am not aware of, end quote. Mr. Tongo explained to Mr. Mbolombo what he wanted. Mr. Mbolombo immediately informed him that there is a young man that he knows who might be prepared to do the job. Mr. Mulombo therefore took his phone, went outside with Mr. Tongo, where they phoned this person and explained to that person about the job. It is common cause that the person that Mr. Mulombo phoned was Mr. Kwabe. Mr. Tongo heard Mr. Mulombo explain to Mr. Kwabe what he, Mr. Tongo, had explained to Mr. Mulombo, and asked whether it would be in order if the person who mandated this deal could make payment in dollars. Mr. Kwabe stated that they, in inverted commas, did not want dollars. It had to be South African rands. Mr. Kwabe stated that he still had to contact a friend. Mr. Tongas testified that while they were outside, he took the particulars of this person, being Mr. Kwabe, from Mr. Mulombo. He could, however, not remember his name and accordingly listed him in his contact list under the letter H. Mr. Tongo phoned Mr. Kwabe at a later stage in order to find out, quote, how things were going, end quote. Mr. Kwabe informed him that things were going just fine, but that he was still going to meet another man and he is, quote, promising, end quote. Mr. Tongo testified that he spoke to the accused later that evening because the accused wanted to make sure that he found the people who would do the job, in inverted commas. He stated that upon informing the accused about the fact that the assailants would not want to be paid in dollars, the accused asked whether he was aware of a place where he could change his dollars. Mr. Tongo knew of such a place because whenever he was tipped by overseas visitors in dollars, that is where he would subsequently exchange them. The accused and Mr. Tongo then arranged for a time to meet the following day so that Mr. Tongo could take the accused to the money changer. Mr. Tongo testified that he was slightly late. He testified that the accused phoned him and asked him whether he had forgotten to come and collect him, and he sounded agitated. Mr. Tongo told the accused that he had been delayed, but that he was on his way to the Cape Grace Hotel from the waterfront. When he arrived at the hotel, the accused immediately came out of the hotel and told Mr. Tongo that they must hurry because his wife was still in the shower or washing. Mr. Tongo stated that he did not know how much the accused was going to change. While he was waiting for the accused in the shop, he heard one of the women who works in the shop say, quote, "This is a lot of money that you are coming to exchange here," end quote. In the car on the way back to the Cape Grace Hotel from the money changer, the discussion about the, quote, the job, end quote, continued. On their arrival at the hotel, Mr. Tongo parked his car and had further discussions with the accused about how the job was going to be done. It is during this discussion that the accused informed Mr. Tongo that he wanted the car to be hijacked, that they must be robbed, whereafter Mr. Tongo must first be dropped off, and then they must also drop him, the accused, along the way, and then they must kill the, quote, business partner, end quote. There was no discussion as to how, where, or when the business partner, in quotations, must be killed. It was then agreed that Mr. Tongo would collect the Dewanis from the Cape Grace Hotel at 7:30 p.m. on the Saturday evening, that he would then show them the waterfront, and that they would then go to Guguletu. Mr. Tongo then made arrangements to meet with Mr. Mbolombo and Mr. Kwabe on the Saturday afternoon. This meeting could not take place because Mr. Tongo had business commitments. Later, an arrangement was made for Mr. Tongo to meet with Mr. Kwabe at the Kaya Bazaar. He later phoned Mr. Kwabe, who told him to wait at a bus stop in Khayelitsha. This Mr. Tongo did. Mr. Kwabe arrived and introduced himself as Spra, which is his nickname, and informed Mr. Tongo that they must meet the other person who is going to work with them. They then drove to the other person, who later transpired to be Mr. Mgeni. Mr. Mgeni got into the car and introduced himself as Kolile. This was Mr. Tongo's first encounter with both Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni. Mr. Kwabe asked Mr. Mgeni whether he remembered that he, Mr. Kwabe, had phoned him, telling him about a job. He then told Mr. Mgeni that, quote, "here is the man," end quote, with reference to Mr. Tongo. Mr. Tongo then explained to them what the accused wanted done. He said the man, with reference to the accused, wanted his business partner, who was going to arrive later that day, to be killed. He wanted it to look like a hijacking. Thereafter, they, in brackets the hijackers, must first drop Mr. Tongo, and after driving on for a while, they must drop the accused, and then lastly, they must kill the business partner. Mr. Tongo then explained that he was going to collect the Dewanis at the Cape Grace Hotel at 7:30 p.m. and would drive around in town with them, from where he would go to Kuguletu and where they would pass Mzoli's place. There is a T-junction in the road where it was arranged that the two young men would wait for Mr. Tongo. Mr. Tongo testified that at one stage he phoned his friend Ta Vuks and asked him whether he wouldn't do the transfer for him. He wanted Ta Vuks to collect the Dewanis and to take them to their required destination. The reason why he did this, he testified, was that, quote, "his knees were shaking," end quote, and he was scared. Ta Vuks could, however, not accommodate him, so he decided to do it himself, because he had already initiated it. On the Saturday evening, Mr. Tongo was running late for his arranged pickup time with the Dewanis. He received a phone call from the accused, who asked him where he was. He told the accused that he was delayed, but that he was on his way. Mr. Tongo testified that on arriving at the Cape Grace Hotel, although he was late, he first cleaned his car and engaged the child locks on both rear doors before he collected the Dewanis. He then texted the accused to say that he was there, and the accused came out with a woman. Mr. Tongo stated that the lady, in inverted commas, was not the same woman as the one who was with the accused on the previous day. He thought that she was the business partner, in inverted commas. The accused and the woman got into the car and they left the Cape Grace Hotel, drove around Cape Town, and then went to Kuguletu. Upon their arrival in Kuguletu, Mr. Tongo did not see Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni at the place where they were supposed to meet, and then suggested to the couple that he take them to Somerset West / Strand, where there is a restaurant on the beach. While on the N2, Mr. Tongo received a phone call from Mr. Kwabe, who apologized for not being at the designated place at the agreed time, and stated that they were having difficulty with transport. Mr. Tongo testified about his reasons for taking the couple to Somerset West. Quote, "Firstly, the reason was that what we have decided did not happen. And secondly, I'm on my way facing in that direction. And thirdly, I would be able to communicate with this young man and find out, because here in the car, I am being looked at with big eyes," end quote. Mr. Tongo testified that when they arrived at Somerset West / Strand, the accused asked him what had happened, because the hit did not take place in Kuguletu as planned. Mr. Tongo then informed the accused that the young men were delayed because of transport problems. He stated that the accused then told him that he must make sure that everything is, quote, "going well," end quote. Mr. Tongo dropped them at the restaurant, where after he went to fill his car with petrol, bought some airtime and went back where he waited for the couple. He contacted Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni and told them where he was. He wanted them to come to Somerset West, but they stated that they could not do so because Somerset West is wet, in inverted commas. Wet, in inverted commas, is a term which indicates that there are many police officers around. Mr. Tonga said that he conveyed that message to the accused and stated that Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni would wait for them in Guguletu at the designated place. Mr. Tonga then stated that he had a telephone conversation with the accused, who inquired whether everything was still going to happen as agreed, whereupon Mr. Tonga informed him that it was. They then proceeded along the N2 towards Guguletu, and Mr. Tonga said that he saw in his rearview mirror that the accused was looking directly at him with wide open eyes, put that in inverted commas. He stated that his knees became weak. Mr. Tonga explained that the money for Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni would be left in the car. In their earlier discussions, it was agreed that the money would be placed in the cubbyhole of the vehicle. But Mr. Tonga testified that the accused told him in Somerset West / Strand that the money was in the pouch behind the left front passenger seat. At all times, it was agreed that the amount that had to be placed in the car was 15,000 rand. Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mlombo, however, both testified that only 10,000 rand was found in the car. Mr. Tonga testified that he had nothing to do with how payment was going to take place, as that was the responsibility of Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni. All he knew was that he, Tonga, would be paid 5,000 rand for his input once the job was done. They then left the Strand. Mr. Tonga turned off the highway into Guguletu, and upon their arrival at the designated place, he noticed Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni waiting for them. They were then hijacked by Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni, who were both armed with handguns. Mr. Tonga was forced to the rear seat next to the accused and the woman. Mr. Kwabe got behind the steering wheel and Mr. Mngeni got into the front passenger seat. Mr. Mngeni robbed the accused and the woman of their valuables and also took Mr. Tonga's cell phone. Mr. Tonga testified that both Mr. Mngeni and Mr. Kwabe had firearms. The one he described as a 9mm and the other as a flywheel, which apparently describes a revolver. During the robbery, Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni instructed everybody to hand over their telephones and everything that they had. Everybody, including Mr. Tonga, obliged. Mr. Tonga stated that he handed over his Nokia E90 because he knew that the robbery was part of the plan. He, however, had another phone, a BlackBerry, which he retained. Mr. Tonga stated that while all this was happening, the deceased was crying, but he cannot remember what she was saying, or in fact whether she said anything. The accused was trying to console her, but he also cannot remember whether he said anything. Everybody was then told to put their heads down, which they did, until they arrived at a spot behind the Guguletu police barracks, where there is a stop sign. At the stop sign, the back door of the vehicle was opened from the outside by Mr. Mngeni. He told Mr. Tonga to get out. Subsequently, Mr. Tonga went to the Guguletu police station where he reported the matter. A statement was taken from him, but Mr. Tonga concedes that he did not tell the truth in that statement. Mr. Tonga told the police that he had forgotten the names of his passengers, but that he knew where they were staying. The police then took Mr. Tonga to the Cape Grace Hotel. He stated that upon arrival at the Cape Grace Hotel, he noticed a police vehicle. Mr. Tonga stated that the accused came out, approached him, and asked him whether he was okay. This discussion took place around midnight. Mr. Tonga stated that from the time that he arrived at the hotel. The accused approached him every now and again to ask him whether he was okay, whether he was fine, and whether he had heard anything. At one stage, Mr. Tongo went outside in the company of a police officer who was known only as Mr. Blacks. Mr. Blacks questioned him and told him that he must not wait to see his time, as he, Mr. Blacks, was of the view that Mr. Tongo knew what had happened. They had an argument and Mr. Tongo went back into the hotel. A CCTV clip was then shown with the accused and Mr. Tongo on the terrace of the Cape Grace Hotel. A cleaner can be seen entering the area where the accused and Mr. Tongo were. He left after the accused apparently asked him to give them some privacy. According to Mr. Tongo, the accused continually kept asking him whether he was fine and also wanted to know whether the job, in inverted commas, had been done. Mr. Tongo replied that he did not know. Mr. Tongo was thereafter taken back to the Guguletu police station. Mr. Blacks also accompanied him to the scene where the hijack took place. Mr. Blacks again questioned Mr. Tongo and told him that he knows about the incident. Mr. Tongo got impatient with Mr. Blacks and then phoned a friend to come and fetch him. Two of his friends arrived to come and fetch him at between 1 and 2 a.m. Thereafter, Mr. Tongo went to the Vanguard Mall to do a SIM swap. He retained his own number. He stated the journalists had tried to get hold of him and ultimately did get hold of him and offered him money for his story. He stated that he had spoken to a certain Mike, in inverted commas, who was working for a newspaper in Britain. On the Tuesday morning, Mr. Tongo phoned Captain Lutchman and explained to him that the journalists were bothering him. Captain Lutchman was at the time in the presence of the accused. Captain Lutchman put the accused on the line to speak to Mr. Tongo. The first thing that the accused asked was whether he, Mr. Tongo, was fine. Mr. Tongo replied that he was not fine, but that he was still alive. The accused said to him that there is a number at which he's going to call Mr. Tongo as he wanted to pay him the outstanding money. Mr. Tongo stated that the accused later phoned him to say that he must come and collect the money, and they arranged that they would meet at the bridge leading to the waterfront coming from the Cape Grace Hotel. Mr. Tongo waited there, but the accused did not show up. Mr. Tongo phoned the accused, who informed him that he could not get out of the hotel because of the presence of all the journalists. He told Mr. Tongo to come to the hotel to collect the money. When Mr. Tongo entered the hotel, he saw the accused standing at the beginning of a corridor. He said that the accused signaled to him that he had to follow him. They moved into the communications center where the accused gave him an envelope in a plastic bag where after he left. Mr. Tongo then went to the toilet where he opened the envelope and counted the money inside and saw that it was only 1,000 rand. He was very angry, folded the envelope and put it in his back pocket. He carried the plastic packet in his hand. As he left the toilet, he looked down the passage to his right to see if he could not see the accused. He did not see the accused and left the hotel. On either the Wednesday or the Thursday, Mr. Tonga was not quite sure, Captain Hendricks contacted him and asked him to visit their offices in Belleville. Mr. Tonga stated that Captain Hendricks begged him that if he knew anything, he had to tell him. He stated that he knew nothing and gave Captain Hendricks a statement, which was false. On the Thursday, Mr. Tongo appointed an attorney, Mr. William de Graaf, to represent him. He stated that he did this, firstly, because he was scared, and secondly, because he knew that the police assaulted people. On Saturday, 20 November 2010, Mr. de Graa informed Mr. Tongo that the police were looking for him. It was arranged that he would go to their offices, where he handed himself over to Captain Hendricks in the presence of his attorney, Mr. de Graa. At that stage, Mr. Tongo was aware that Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni had been arrested. Mr. Tongo entered into a plea and sentence agreement with the state, which was signed on 5 December 2010. On 7 December 2010, he was convicted and sentenced in accordance with the plea and sentence agreement by Judge President Schlope. His sentence was one of 18 years imprisonment. Mr. Tongo stated that he realized that the deceased was killed on the Sunday morning for the first time. That was also the first time that he found out that the deceased was in fact the wife of the accused. Mr. Tongo stated that the accused never discussed a helicopter trip with him. Mr. Tongo was thereafter questioned about the role of Mr. Mbolombo. Mr. Tongo was adamant that Mr. Mbolombo's only role was to connect Mr. Tongo with Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni. He stated that after the incident, Mr. Mbolombo contacted him because he wanted his money from Mr. Tongo, and Mr. Tongo informed him that he must get his money from Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mngeni. Mr. Tongo explained that he decided to cooperate with the police because he realized that what he did was wrong, that he was a fool, and that he had been misled. In terms of the plea agreement entered into by Mr. Tongo, he indicated his willingness to testify in any subsequent criminal trials instituted in regard to the alleged conspiracy. To this end, a comprehensive affidavit was obtained from him by Lieutenant Colonel Barkhuizen. Mr. Tongo and his attorney, Mr. de Graa, who was also present throughout, were given the opportunity to consider the final typed version of this document, whereafter on the 26th of November 2010, 13 days after the incident, Mr. Tongo signed the affidavit. This affidavit was handed in as an exhibit during the course of the trial. Mr. Tongo's plea agreement, which was signed by him and his attorney on the 5th of December 2010, was also handed in as an exhibit. Cross-examination. During cross-examination, a slightly different picture emerged from the evidence of Mr. Tongo. Mr. Tongo's evidence was riddled with contradictions. Some of these contradictions relate merely to peripheral issues, and I will not deal with them in any great detail. However, others are far more fundamental. His evidence and the version of events which he gave are also highly improbable. But having said that, it must be borne in mind that at this stage of the proceedings, credibility plays a limited role. The shortcomings in his evidence must be carefully scrutinized to determine whether his evidence is so poor that the court can ignore it. When Mr. Tongo was confronted with these contradictions and or improbabilities, his refrain was either that he had, quote, made a mistake, end quote, or that as time went by, his memory of the events of the evening had improved. It is self-evident that the circumstances under which the agreement which underlies this conspiracy was entered into is material. In this regard, Mr. Tonga testified in chief that upon arrival at the Cape Grace Hotel on the Friday, and after the accused had handed him his fare, he handed the accused his business card. The accused then told him that he has a job for him and that he must wait for him for a few minutes whilst he goes to the reception desk to check in. In cross-examination, Mr. Tongo confirmed that it was only after the accused had returned from the reception desk that he learned that the job entailed the killing of a person. In his affidavit, however, Mr. Tongo stated This discussion took place before the accused went to the reception area. Therefore, the accused asked Mr. Tongo to kill someone within minutes of arriving at the Cape Grace Hotel, having met Mr. Tongo at most 30 minutes earlier. Mr. Tongo, who is not a person with a criminal record, then told him that he does not associate himself with, quote, such things, end quote, but immediately indicated that he could call somebody in the township who may know somebody who associated himself with that type of life. That person we now know was Mr. Mulombo. By poor coincidence, his friend, Mr. Mulombo, immediately agreed to assist him, phoned Mr. Kwabe, who also quite coincidentally was happy to oblige for a fee of 15,000 rand. On their version, quite by chance, Mr. Kwabe was in the company of Mr. Mgeni when the call came through from Mr. Tongo. On Mr. Tongo's own evidence, this was the first time in his life that he received a request to assist in the killing of a person. And although the contradiction as to when this discussion actually took place may in itself not seem significant, when looked at in context, it becomes very significant. Mr. Tongo testified that when the accused returned to his vehicle from the reception, he told him that he has a job for him that will make his business grow, and because he is from overseas, he can refer other travelers to Mr. Tongo. Thereafter, the accused said that there was somebody to be killed. The person to be killed was his business partner, who would be arriving the next day. The accused said that he was prepared to pay 15,000 to have her killed, 15,000 rand, sorry, to have her killed, which amount would be payable after the job had been done. He also undertook to pay Mr. Tongo 5,000 rand after the job had been done. The accused therefore expanded on his initial request when he returned from the reception area. Mr. Tongo was adamant throughout his evidence that what actually persuaded him to get involved in the commission of this crime was the promise by the accused that he would make his business grow rather than the 5,000 rand remuneration which he was offered. In his affidavit, however, no mention whatsoever is made of the so-called promise by the accused to refer clients to him and to grow his business. When one considers that this was the main motivating factor why Mr. Tongo, who had never previously been involved in criminal activities, was prepared to get involved, it is indeed strange that he did not mention this in his statement. For this discrepancy, Mr. Tongo blames Lieutenant Colonel Barkhuizen, who took his statement. Then there is the question of the identity of the person that had to be killed. In his statement, Mr. Tongo stated that the person that had to be killed was a woman and that she was arriving later that evening, end quote. In his plea agreement, Mr. Tongo describes the person who must be killed as a, quote, client of the accused. In his evidence, he testified that the accused explained that the person to be killed is his, quote, business partner, end quote, who would be arriving the next day. Mr. Tonga even stated in his evidence quite categorically that the woman that he went to pick up at the hotel on the Saturday evening was not the deceased. However, in his statement, he specifically said that the woman that he picked up at the hotel on the Saturday evening was the same lady. When confronted with these startling contradictions, he once again blamed it on Lieutenant Colonel Barkhuizen. Both in his plea explanation and in his affidavit, Mr. Tongo stated that the accused had asked him if he knew of a place where he could exchange his dollars for rands and where he did not have to produce his passport. This money was, according to Mr. Tongo, earmarked to pay the killers. In cross-examination, it transpired that the accused never indicated that he did not want to produce his passport. His passport was, in fact, never mentioned. Mr. Tongo stated that that was just something that he, Mr. Tongo, thought. That is his explanation for including it in his statement. And this he attributes to a mistake. This is a serious mistake, because if in fact the accused deliberately wanted to act in a manner to hide the fact that he had changed money to pay the killers, it would certainly call for an explanation from the accused. It is a further indication of how Mr. Tongo was prepared to lie in a way which creates an atmosphere of suspicion regarding the accused. Mr. Tonga testified that he drove from the Cape Grace Hotel to the Proteo Coliseum Hotel at Century City to see his friend Monde Malombo. He told Mr. Malombo that he had transported clients from the airport to the Cape Grace Hotel, where the accused said that he had a job for him. He proceeded to explain to Mr. Malombo what the job was, namely that the accused wants somebody who would be arriving the next day to be taken, quote, out of sight, end quote. Mr. Malombo, who similarly does not have a criminal record, immediately said that there is a young man that he knows and that he is going to phone and explain to him about the job. Mr. Malombo then phoned this person and explained to him exactly what Mr. Tongo had told him. According to Mr. Tongo, Mr. Malombo told the person at the other end of the phone, who we now know to be Mr. Kwabe, that the person, presumably with reference to the accused, said he wanted his business partner, who will be arriving the next day, killed, and that he was prepared to pay 15,000 rand for the job. Mr. Bolombo also inquired whether Mr. Kwabe would be prepared to accept dollars as payment, but he was informed that they wanted rands. Mr. Tonga did not mention anything in his evidence in chief regarding any possible payment to Mr. Malombo for his efforts. In cross-examination, he stated that Mr. Malombo was going to be paid, but not by him, but by the young men, referring to Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Ngeni. This, he testifies, is something that he now, in inverted commas, remembers. Mr. Tonga further testified that he could not remember how much money Mr. Malombo was going to be paid by the young men, but that was their concern. It had nothing to do with him, Tonga. However, in his affidavit, he stated that Mr. Malombo wanted 5,000 rand for organizing Mr. Kwabe, the hitman, and that Mr. Malombo suggested, quote, we should pay Kwabe only 10,000 rand, and that he, Malombo, would take 5,000 rand. Mr. Tongo then explained that Mr. Malombo did say that he wanted 5,000 rand, but that how much money he was going to earn really had nothing to do with him. He responded as follows, quote, Monde was going to get his share, m'lady. Whether he was going to get 5,000 rand, 2,000 rand, or 1,000 rand, I do not know, end of quote. Thereafter, he was confronted with his plea explanation, where he stated, quote, Monde said he wanted 5,000 rand for organizing the hitman and that we should pay the hitman 10,000 rand, end quote. To this, Mr. Tonga once again replied that Mr. Malombo was at all times going to get his share, but how much his share was, he does not know. And then stated that he does not remember that Mr. Malombo stated that he wanted 5,000 rand. Mr. Tongo's evidence in this regard is telling, and I quote, Monde, according to what is written here, maybe I can't recall that very well. He wanted 5,000 rand, if that is the case. My response to him was that the young men are going to pay you. So you remember now that he wanted 5,000 rand and that you told him that the young men would be paying him? Do I understand you correctly? That is correct, sir. Why didn't you tell the police that in your statement? Maybe that was just forgotten, but it is written here, sir. That was forgotten, but you did not forget twice to relay the fact that Monde wanted 5,000 rand and stated that the hitman should get 10,000 rand. Is that correct? I said everybody makes mistakes. As you also said, I am ZH, but I am ZR. This evidence is indicative of how Mr. Tongo could change his version under pressure of cross-examination without the slightest hesitation. This aspect of Mr. Tongo's evidence raises a further important question. At all material times, the accused only had dealings with Mr. Tongo. He had never even met Mr. Mbilombo, Mr. Kwabe, or Mr. Mgeni. The only person with whom the accused could negotiate to pay the various role players was Mr. Tongo. There was no evidence that Mr. Tongo had received any money from the accused, which he could hand over to the two young men to pay Mr. Mlombo. Nor was it ever suggested that the accused was instrumental in getting any money to them. In addition, both Mr. Mlombo and Mr. Kwabe contradict Mr. Tongo on just about every aspect of their interactions on the Friday evening. Mr. Mbilombo testified that Mr. Tongo told him that there is something he wanted to talk to him about. On his question as to what Mr. Tongo wanted to talk about, Mr. Tongo said to him, "Is there no one that I know who is a hitman?" Put that in quotation marks. Mr. Mbilombo then phoned Mr. Kwabe and told him that there is a person with him whose name is Zola who is looking for a hitman. Mr. Kwabe asked him whether he knew this person. He responded by saying that he does know Mr. Tongo, whereupon Mr. Kwabe inquired how much they would be paid if they agreed to do the job. Mr. Mbilombo did not know, called Mr. Tongo closer, switched off the phone, and found out what the agreed remuneration would be. Thereafter, he redialed Mr. Kwabe's number and informed him that Mr. Tongo said they would be earning 15,000 rand. Mr. Kwabe then stated that they should not discuss the matter any further over the phone, but make arrangements to meet. Mr. Mbilombo further testified that on hearing about the 15,000 rand, he told Mr. Tongo that he, Mr. Mbilombo, should also get something for his efforts, even if it is 5,000 rand for his involvement. To this, Mr. Tongo did not respond. Mr. Mbilombo testified that on the Friday night, he had no idea who the person was who was going to be killed, and that he did not ask Mr. Tongo. He contradicts Mr. Tongo's evidence that he explained to Mr. Mbilombo that the accused wanted his business partner, who was arriving the next day, killed. Mr. Kwabe stated that he has no recollection that there was any reference to dollars in his telephonic discussion with Mr. Mbilombo, and stated that had there been mention of dollars, he would have remembered it. He also denied any arrangement that he and Mr. Mgeni would have paid Mr. Mbilombo anything. Accordingly, the evidence of Mr. Mbilombo, Mr. Kwabe, and Mr. Tongo do not support each other. Mr. Tongo testified that he phoned Mr. Kwabe later on the Friday evening as he wanted to know how things were going, whereupon Mr. Kwabe responded that everything was going fine and that he was still going to meet with another man and, quote, "he is promising," end quote. Mr. Kwabe's version of his telephonic discussion completely contradicts Mr. Tongo's testimony. According to Mr. Kwabe, Mr. Tongo told him that he needed somebody to be killed and asked him whether he knew anybody who can do it. At that stage, Mr. Kwabe testified that he was in Mr. Mgeni's company, who said that he would be prepared to do it. Mr. Tongo thereupon asked him for what fee they would be prepared to do it, and Mr. Mgeni then responded by saying he would do it for 15,000 rand. They then agreed to meet the following day. During cross-examination, Mr. Kwabe testified that Mr. Tongo had told him that there was a husband who wanted his wife, in brackets, not a business partner, close brackets, killed. Mr. Kwabe was at pains to stress that the amount of 15,000 rand was determined by Mr. Mgeni and not by Mr. Tongo. The two versions of what happened during this telephone conversation are clearly irreconcilable. Mr. Tongo's evidence regarding the events on Saturday morning was clearly tendered with the intention to create the impression that the accused had to change the dollars into rands to be able to pay the hitman, and that the accused was very anxious to do so. That is why Mr. Tongo testified that he had received a call from the accused in which the accused, in an agitated state, asked him whether he had forgotten about their appointment to go to the money changer. Mr. Tongo further testified that he then rushed to the Cape Grace Hotel, and when he arrived, the accused immediately came walking out of the door. The accused told him that they must hurry as his wife was having a shower or washing. This evidence was proved by the CCTV footage to be untrue. The CCTV footage shows that the accused and the deceased appeared from their bedroom shortly before 11:15 a.m. The accused was dressed in shorts, sandals, and a grey polo shirt, and had his sunglasses on his head. The deceased was dressed in white trousers and a pink top, also with sunglasses on her head. The court was informed that there was CCTV footage available to show that they then went to breakfast and thereafter went to the pool. This footage was, however, not shown. At 11:52:19, Mr. Tongo texted the accused, and at 11:53, the accused replied in a text by saying, quote, okay, give me 10 minutes, end quote. The CCTV footage shows that the accused had changed from his pool clothes into trousers and a golf shirt. There is no record whatsoever of a telephone call made by the accused to Mr. Tongo on that Saturday morning. The CCTV footage denies the fact that the accused was in a hurry and desperate to go to the money changer. In fact, it seems apparent that the accused was late for the appointment and still had to go to his room to change before going to the money changer. Mr. Mobb conceded that Mr. Tongo exaggerated the haste with which the accused wanted the transaction done, but stated that this is not a deliberate falsehood, but understandable in view of the time that has lapsed since the incident. I do not agree. This evidence was clearly tendered with a view to create the impression that the accused was extremely anxious to have the money changed and which he was due to pay the killers. Mr. Tonga further testified that upon their return from the money changer at the Cape Grace Hotel, he and the accused discussed how the job should be done. The accused said that he wanted the car hijacked. Then they must be robbed. Whereafter the hijackers must first drop Mr. Tonga and then himself, whereafter they must kill the woman. The further details of the evening were also discussed. Mr. Tongo confirmed in cross-examination that this discussion took place after their arrival from the money changer at the hotel whilst they were sitting in Mr. Tongo's parked car. However, he was then shown CCTV footage of them arriving from the money changer. The car had hardly stopped when the accused alighted and walked towards the hotel. On the CCTV footage, one then sees the car leaving the hotel. It was therefore clearly a figment of Mr. Tongo's imagination that the discussion took place in the parking lot of the hotel. Once Mr. Tongo was caught out on this lie, he again changed tack with apparent ease and stated that the conversation actually took place in the motor vehicle while they were driving, and once again called this discrepancy a mistake. Mr. Tongo further testified that he told Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni that the 15,000 rand would be in the cubbyhole of his vehicle because that was what had been agreed with the accused that morning. Mr. Tongo was then confronted with his statement in which he said, the first man, in brackets Mr. Kwabe, said that we had to leave the 15,000 rand in the cubbyhole of my vehicle as they wanted payment available to them as soon as the job had been done. In his evidence, he told the court explicitly that it was the decision of Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni that the 15,000 rand had to be left in the cubbyhole. When it was put to him that his earlier evidence was that the accused agreed with him that morning that the money should be left in the cubbyhole, he suddenly could no longer remember whether the accused had said that. The one fact that is, however, of crucial importance is that Mr. Tongo knew when he left the Cape Grace Hotel on the Saturday evening that there was no money whatsoever in the cubbyhole. There is also no suggestion that Mr. Tongo, before he left the hotel, asked the accused for the money. He did not even know whether the accused had the money with him. Questioned about what would happen to his motor vehicle after the woman had been killed, he testified that Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni had to abandon the car on the spot where they were going to kill the woman. Later, he testified that he did not know where they were going to leave the motor vehicle. At yet a later stage, he was confronted with the audio recording of a telephone discussion which took place between him and Mr. Mbolombo at 18:38 on the Saturday evening, during which Mr. Mbolombo said, oh, so the car should get there and get washed. That's a quote. Mr. Tonga responded, and I quote, once this thing has been done, Kwabe and Mgeni was to leave the car near the car wash that was, and then a few dots, close to Mlombo's house in Khayelitsha. End quote. This discrepancy he could not explain. To expose his vehicle, which was his livelihood, to this kind of risk cannot be believed. Mr. Tongo's evidence about whether he knew the identities of Mr. and Mrs. Kwabe, Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni, is also strange. In his statement, he refers to Mr. Kwabe as the first man, Mr. Mgeni as the second man. He also stated that he was never introduced to them. However, in his evidence in chief, he testified that both Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni introduced themselves to him on the Saturday afternoon, even though he denied that he had known their names. First, he tried to attribute this to the police taking down his evidence incorrectly. He then tried to say that he could not remember their names, and then he replied, quote, let's say then that's a mistake that happened that I never mentioned, but they did introduce themselves to me and I just forgot their names. But as time went on, I then remembered their names again. The court is going to take the adjournment at this stage. Mr. Fonsell, I noticed when we adjourned that your client is sitting. Could you ask him to stand for the duration? The inference is irresistible that initially Mr. Tongo wanted to bring the investigating officers under the impression that he did not know the names of Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni. It must be remembered that Mr. Tongo's affidavit was not just an ordinary police statement. It was taken down in anticipation of the accused entering into a plea and sentence agreement and in the presence of his attorney, Mr. De Graaf. The final typed version of this affidavit was handed to Mr. De Graaf and Mr. Tongo for consideration before it was signed. It was a statement taken by an extremely senior police officer. It cannot be equated to a, quote, run-of-the-mill, end quote, police statement. In fact, Mr. Tongo confirms in this statement that, quote, the facts contained in this affidavit are true to the best of my knowledge and belief. I am aware that I make myself liable to prosecution were I willfully to state anything therein, sick, that I know to be false or do not believe to be true. Paragraph. I have been informed that were anybody to be arrested and prosecuted in regard to any incident or fact that I refer to in this affidavit, I may be called as a witness to testify for the state. I have further been informed that were criminal proceedings to ensue, a copy of this affidavit may be made available to the accused and or his legal counsel prior to the trial to enable them to prepare for his, her, or their defense. It was agreed in terms of the common cause facts that the accused and the deceased had a booking at a restaurant in Somerset West, which was made by the staff members of the Cape Grace Hotel. Mr. Tongo, however, testified that when Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni did not show up at the predetermined place in Guguletu, it was he who suggested to the Dewanis that he take them to Somerset West. This was indeed a strange coincidence. Mr. Tongo's explanation as to why he engaged the child locks of both the rear doors cannot be believed. He stated that he did not know on which side the accused would sit and on which side the deceased would sit. Seeing that this was all part of a conspiracy with the accused in which the accused was going to be the second person to be dropped from the vehicle, it is simply not a credible explanation. How was the accused going to get out of the vehicle? The fact that he engaged the child locks was also not mentioned in his affidavit. It appears that Mr. Tongo decided to give this evidence only after he had been confronted by the CCTV footage where this is clearly shown. It will be recalled that Mr. Tongo testified that it was agreed with Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni that the accused would leave the 15,000 rand for the killing in the cubbyhole of the vehicle. Mr. Tongo conceded that Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni were dangerous individuals. He knew that they would be armed. He, however, drove to the agreed hijack spot with the deceased and the accused in the car, without the money being in the cubbyhole or without even establishing from the accused whether he had the money with him. It must further be remembered that according to Mr. Tongo, the initial plan was that the hijack would take place when Mr. Tongo first drove into Guguletu. At that stage, there was therefore no suggestion that they would drive to Somerset West, and Mr. Tongo knew that the money was not in the cubbyhole. Yet, in his affidavit, he stated that after he had picked up the accused and the deceased at the Cape Grace Hotel, quote, the accused instructed me to first drive around town as he wanted to see what the city looked like at night, and then through to Somerset West, where they planned to have dinner, end quote. This is irreconcilable with his evidence that it was his, Mr. Tongo's, decision to take the couple to Somerset West. When confronted with this, it was again a mistake. Importantly, Mr. Tongo testified that when the hijack did not take place at the place and time initially agreed upon, he received a text message from the accused inquiring from him what is happening. When it was pointed out to him that there was no such SMS record on record, which was common cause between the parties, he stated that the records were wrong. This is yet a further untruth told by Mr. Tongo in an attempt to incriminate the accused. Mr. Tongo also claimed that there was telephonic communication between him and the accused while they were underway from Guguletu to the Strand. Once again, he was confronted with the documentary evidence that there was no such communication indicated on the documentation. Once again, Mr. Tongo stated that there might be a problem with the records, although they were agreed upon between the state and the defense. As regards the events on the Saturday evening, on their arrival at the Strand, Mr. Tongo testified that he and the accused were walking ahead of the woman on their way to the restaurant. The accused then asked him softly what had happened. He explained to the accused that the men were delayed as a result of a problem with a motor vehicle, but that they were going to wait in Guguletu. The accused then told him that he must make sure that everything is, quote, going well, end quote. However, in Mr. Tonga's affidavit, he states the following, quote, Dewani and the lady first took a stroll on the beach, and then I walked with them to the restaurant. At the entrance, the lady went in, and Dewani turned around and spoke to me. He asked what is happening. He appeared to be stressed, and he threatened me. He said if the job was not done that evening, he was going to kill me. I told him that I would call the man I had arranged for the job and asked him what was happening. I then went to my car while Dewani went into the restaurant to have supper. When confronted with this statement in his affidavit, he said that the contents thereof was not the truth. The accused said he never said, Mr. Tonga stated that the accused never said he was going to kill him. He stated that this was a mistake made, maybe, I quote, by the one who typed it wrong, maybe just a mistake. He was then asked, quote, did you tell Colonel Barkaysen in the presence of your attorney when this statement was taken down that the accused at the Surfside restaurant asked you what happened and then threatened you by saying that if the job was not done that evening, he was going to kill you? Did you tell Colonel Barkaysen that? I never said that, lady. I said that I must remember that I am the one who is having the knowledge. So Colonel Barkaysen simply wrote down, although you never said it, it's the same as the mistake that he made by saying, oh yeah, end quote. This story about the accused threatening Mr. Tongo must be considered in view of the objective evidence, namely the audio recordings. They show that at 21:31:55, Mr. Mlambo called Mr. Kwabe. In the course of this telephone discussion, Mr. Mlambo told Mr. Kwabe, quote, it's that thing we were talking about, it must happen today, end quote. It is common cause that Mr. Mlambo had not spoken to Mr. Tongo since 1838 that evening, and yet in the above-mentioned telephone call, he is clearly instructing Mr. Kwabe that the hijacking must take place that night. How could Mr. Mlambo have known about the discussion and the threat between the accused and Mr. Tongo? Mr. Tongo further testified that during the discussion between him and the accused, whilst they were in Somerset West / Strand, the accused told him that he had put the money in the pouch of the front passenger seat. He further testified that he conveyed this message to Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni. He cannot recall whether that was done by means of a text. After this evidence, he was confronted with what he had stated in his affidavit, where he stated the following. Quote, whilst I was driving, it was either on the way to Somerset West or after we had departed from Somerset West, I realized that Dewani had not discussed the money that was destined to be paid over to the men. I then sent him a text message, don't forget the money. He then answered, also by text, informing me that the money was in an envelope in the pouch behind the passenger seat. In other words, at the original time when the hijack was supposed to take place, the accused had not placed any money in the vehicle. Mr. Tongo concedes that this paragraph reflects what he had told Lieutenant Colonel Barkhuizen, but states that it was not the truth. His explanation about this discrepancy mirrors a theme that came throughout his evidence. I quote, it's going back to what I said, m'lady. As I said, as time goes by or goes on, some things just resurface. And now I can remember some of the things much better or well, end quote. The accused, in his plea explanation, stated that after the attackers had hijacked the vehicle, there was a person with a gun in his hand next to him on the seat. Mr. Tongo stated that that was a lie because it was he, Mr. Tongo, that was forced into the rear seat and was sitting next to the accused. He did not have a firearm. Once again, Mr. Tongo was confronted with the following statement in his affidavit. Quote, the first man, that's Kwabe, got into the driver's seat and pushed me over to the passenger seat. The second man got into the back of the vehicle with Dewani and the lady. Mr. Tongo found himself in a predicament that he had now placed himself in the back seat with the child locks engaged. He needed to explain now how he would have left the vehicle. His evidence in this regard is virtually incomprehensible and totally irreconcilable with his affidavit, in which he stated that the driver, in brackets Mr. Kwabe, close brackets, put his firearm against my head and ordered me out of the vehicle, end quote. Once again, he stated that this allegation, that Mr. Kwabe put a firearm against his head, was another mistake. A CCTV clip was shown in which the accused and Mr. Tongo were on the terrace of the Cape Grace Hotel. According to the accused, Mr. Tongo, the accused continually kept asking him whether he was fine and also wanted to know from him whether the job had been done. Mr. Tongo replied that he did not know. The accused also asked him whether Mr. Tongo had any information as to whether the men really did what they were supposed to do. This was obviously a vitally important discussion. Yet, in Mr. Tongo's affidavit, not a word is mentioned about it. It is appropriate to quote from the affidavit. I quote, the police then took me through to the Cape Grace Hotel. When we arrived, there was a marked police vehicle from the Harare police station also parked there. When we got to the reception, I saw another two policemen standing with Dewani in the reception area. I then pointed out Dewani to them. Dewani spoke to me briefly and inquired whether I was okay. The policeman then had a discussion while I sat on the couch. I then heard the policeman referring to the lady as Dewani's wife. That was the first time that I realized that the lady that Dewani wanted us to murder was his wife. Dewani then went to the police, with the police, to another office, end quote. It is clear that Mr. Tongo's evidence that the accused wanted to know whether the job had been done or whether the young men had done what they were supposed to do was something that he had made up to incriminate the accused once he had viewed the CCTV footage. It is also common cause that Mr. Tongo never, during the course of all these discussions, asked the accused for his 5,000 rand remuneration. It will be recalled that Mr. Tongo testified that the accused handed him an envelope with R1,000 on Tuesday, the 16th of November 2016. However, in his affidavit, he makes no mention of having received any money from the accused. He makes mention of this for the first time in a statement dated the 22nd of December 2010, most probably after he had been confronted with the CCTV footage. In that statement, he states that he was scared to admit that he had received money because he believed that it would increase his participation in the offence. In his evidence, however, he had a different explanation for not disclosing this. And I quote, the reason for me to admit that with them, and I did not admit that at the beginning or on the beginning, it's because I was scared, m'lady, for such a big job that I have done, then now I get only an amount of R1,000, end quote. It appears far more probable that Mr. Tongo did not want to reveal the fact that he received the R1,000 from the accused, as it would have flown in the face of his entire story. Another strange aspect of his evidence is the fact that he did not throw away the empty plastic bag after he was in the toilet. He rather left the hotel carrying the empty plastic bag, which on his own version, he was carrying by the handles. During a viewing of the CCTV footage, it was pointed out to the court that there is a shadow of something inside the plastic bag, and that the manner in which Mr. Tongo was carrying the bag also indicated that there was something inside. The purpose of this evidence was that it was put to Mr. Tongo that there was a thank you card from the accused in the envelope with R1,000. Mr. Tongo denied this. In cross-examination, Mr. Tongo deals with this as follows. Quote, "That's not true, m'lady. The plastic bag is a little bit hard. If you are holding it correctly on the top side, that's now where the handles are, it might appear that there is something inside the plastic bag, whereas as it is empty and with nothing inside. It might appear to you as if there is something inside, whereas there is actually nothing inside." This answer speaks for itself. As stated above, Mr. Tongo was clear that the only role that Monde Malombo played was as a go-between between him, Mr. Kwabe, and Mr. Ngeni. As he was cross-examined, the thread of his evidence that, quote, "as time goes by, he can remember more and more," end quote, continued. He could then remember that he phoned Mr. Malombo on his way to Somerset West because he wanted to know from Mr. Malombo why Kwabe and Mgeni did not do the job. Eventually, he conceded that Mr. Malombo's role included assisting him, Mr. Tongo, quote, "to make sure that everything just happens," end quote. When Mr. Tongo was confronted with the various audio recordings of telephone calls which make it clear that Mr. Malombo played a much bigger role than simply being the link or an assistant to Mr. Tongo, he kept on protecting Mr. Malombo by sticking to his version that he was merely an assistant. Mr. Malombo was forced to concede during cross-examination that he was the person who was actually in control of the events on the Saturday night. The contents of the audio recordings in this regard become significant. I quote from an audio recording of a call from Mr. Malombo to Mr. Tongo from the Protea cordless handset. This call was made at 18:38 on Saturday, 13 November. It must be recorded that this is only the words of Mr. Malombo. One cannot hear what the person on the other side is saying. I quote, "No, there's two of them." "Yes, huh? There's five of us, remember? So you will leave him here with, it is what? Oh, so the car should get there and get washed. No, then I hear you, Grootman, at that place. Mr. Tonga was asked about the reference to there are five of us. He tried to explain that the five people that Mr. Mulombo was referring to was himself, Mr. Mulombo, Mr. Kwabe, Mr. Mgeni, and the accused. However, Mr. Mulombo did not testify that he ever counted the accused as one of the five. From the foregoing, it's clear that Mr. Tonga contradicted his affidavit made to Lieutenant Colonel Barkhuizen in virtually every material respect. His evidence is also inherently contradictory. In some instances, it makes no sense, and in others, his explanations are laughable. His evidence is contradicted on material points by his accomplices, Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mulombo. But apart from the contradictions, the entire story, as told by Mr. Tongo, is highly improbable. I say this for the following reasons. The accused met Mr. Tongo at the airport when he was looking for a taxi to take him and his wife to the Cape Grace Hotel. Mr. Tonga was a shuttle operator. On all accounts, he was neatly dressed and his car was in a good condition. It was never suggested that the meeting between the accused and Mr. Tonga was prearranged. In other words, the accused simply approached Mr. Tonga because he was the first taxi driver that he came across as he walked out of the airport. On their way to the Cape Grace Hotel, Mr. Tonga attempted to sell his services as a guide to the accused and his wife, offering to show them around Cape Town. There could have been no indication to the accused that Mr. Tonga was anything other than a law-abiding shuttle operator and a guide. Can this court, without some credible corroboration, for one moment accept that the accused, after he had been in Mr. Tongo's company for approximately 30 minutes, would without more approach him with a request that he find somebody to kill his business partner? It is even more improbable that Mr. Tongo, who says he has never been involved in any criminal activity, will virtually immediately agree to contact his friend, Mr. Mulombo, to obtain the services of a hitman. Even if one accepts that he was offered 5,000 rand at that stage, it must be kept in mind that Mr. Tonga testified that in a good month he earned between 30 and 40,000 rand per month with his car. Again, the question arises, would such a person risk his vehicle, his income, his future, and his freedom for a mere 5,000 rand? It is equally strange that Mr. Tonga immediately approaches Mr. Mulombo, who is a hotel receptionist, who on his own evidence has the wherewithal to contact people telephonically because he works as a receptionist in the hotel. It is even stranger that Mr. Mulombo, without any promise of financial gain, almost immediately agreed to assist by phoning Mr. Kwabe. Clearly aware of these problems, Mr. Mop argued, with reference to State versus Francis, 1991, 1, South African Criminal Law Reports, 198A, that it is not necessarily expected of an accomplice that he should be wholly consistent and wholly reliable or even wholly truthful. The ultimate test, after cautiously considering the accomplice's evidence, is whether the court is satisfied beyond reasonable doubt that in its essential features, the story he tells is true. The passage upon which Mr. Mop relies must be looked at in context. At 205E to G, Smallberger JA stated, in my view, Dee's evidence has not been shown to be substantially flawed. There are no material contradictions or inconsistencies in his evidence, nor are there improbabilities in his evidence of such a degree as to render his veracity suspect. He has not been shown to have been a deliberately untruthful witness. At best, for accused number five, it can be said that Dee was not a perfect witness who gave unblemished evidence. it is not necessarily expected of an accomplice before his evidence can be accepted that he should be wholly consistent and wholly reliable or even wholly truthful. The ultimate test is whether, after due consideration of the accomplice's evidence, with the caution that the law enjoins, the court is satisfied beyond all reasonable doubt that it, in its essential features, the story he tells is true. By contrast, in Mr. Tongo's case, there were manifest material contradictions and inconsistencies in his evidence. And, as pointed out, there are a number of improbabilities of such a degree as to render his evidence suspect. In my view, Mr. Tongo's evidence is of a very poor quality. It was conceded by Mr. Mock that there were deviations and contradictions, but he argued that his evidence was not of such poor quality that the court can draw a proverbial line through it. But that is not the test. The test is, approached with the required caution, I can find that his evidence is such that a reasonable court, acting carefully, might convict. There are undoubtedly aspects of Mr. Tongo's evidence which implicate the accused. But his evidence is of such a poor quality that one simply does not know where the lies end and the truth begins. A court should not, under those circumstances, cherry-pick certain parts of his evidence which can possibly be accepted and others which should be rejected. Reliable corroboration is required in such circumstances. In sharp contrast, when his evidence is considered with that of Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mlombo, the picture becomes even bleaker for the state case. I will now proceed to discuss the evidence of the two other accomplice witnesses, Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mlombo. Mr. Kwabe's evidence in chief was that he received a call from Mr. Mlombo on the Friday evening, who told him that there was a job that needed to be done. He agreed that Mr. Mlombo could give his telephone number to the person who wants the job done. He testified that Mr. Tongo called him later and told him that he obtained his number from Mr. Mlombo and that he had a job that needed to be done, namely, somebody needed to be killed. Mr. Tongo also inquired how much it would cost. At the time, Mr. Kwabe was with Mr. Mgeni and asked Mr. Mgeni whether he would be prepared to partake and what he would charge. Mr. Mgeni said that he would do it for 15,000 rand. It was then agreed with Mr. Tongo that they would meet the following day and discuss the matter. On Saturday, Mr. Kwabe received a call from Mr. Tongo and they arranged to meet at the Kaya Bazaar in Khayelitsha. Mr. Tongo described the motor vehicle which he would be driving. Mr. Kwabe waited for him at the agreed place, and when Mr. Tongo arrived, he recognized the car. Mr. Kwabe introduced himself as Spra, which was his next name. Mr. Tongo told him that there was a husband who wanted a wife killed. He told Mr. Tongo to wait because he is not in this alone and that they must go to his friend's house, who transpired to be Mr. Mgeni. Mr. Mgeni joined them in the vehicle and introduced himself to Tongo as Kolile. Mr. Tongo then told Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni that there was a husband who wanted the wife killed and that had to look like a hijacking. Mr. Tongo told them which route he was going to be taking and explained that he would drive to Guguletu near Mzoli's, and they agreed on where the hijacking would take place, which was on the corner of NY112 and NY108. They also agreed that the remuneration of 15,000 rand would be paid and told Tongo to leave the money in the cubbyhole. It was agreed that the woman would be killed, but nothing would happen to Tongo and the accused. Mr. Tongo told them that he would give them a call when he left and that it would be something past 7 on the Saturday evening. On the Saturday evening, Mr. Tongo called Mr. Kwabe saying that they were now leaving the hotel. Mr. Kwabe phoned Mr. Mgeni, but they struggled to get transport. On their way, Mr. Tongo phoned them and informed them that he had already left Kukuletu because they were not at the appointed time when he arrived, and that he was on his way to Somerset West with the accused and the deceased. They agreed, quote, to let the matter stand over for another time, end quote. Mr. Tongo again phoned Kwabe at a later stage and informed him that he was at a restaurant in Somerset West / Strand and told him that, quote, the job had to be done the same evening. The husband wanted his wife killed the same evening, end quote. Mr. Tongo also informed him that he would be taking the same route to Kukuletu and that he and Mr. Mgeni should meet him at the place agreed upon. Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni got a lift to Kukuletu. Mr. Mgeni had Mr. Kwabe's Norinco pistol. Mr. Kwabe was unarmed but took yellow kitchen gloves along to prevent fingerprints. Mr. Kwabe received a text message from Mr. Tongo to say that he was close by. They then saw Mr. Tongo's car approaching. Mr. Mgeni stopped Mr. Tongo's car by pointing his firearm at the occupants. Mr. Kwabe got in behind the steering wheel and Mr. Mgeni got into the front passenger seat while Mr. Tongo got into the back seat. Mr. Kwabe stopped at the intersection near to the police barracks where Mr. Tongo was ordered out of the car. As Mr. Tongo was getting out, he told them in Xhosa that the money was in the pouch behind the front passenger seat. Mr. Kwabe then drove with the accused and the deceased along the N2 in the direction of Khayelitsha. They had no plan as to what they would do. He took the Baden Power turnoff and stopped between Harare and Kuyasa, where the accused was ordered out of the vehicle. He then drove further with the deceased and Mgeni in the car into Muwe between Harare and Ndlovini, an informal settlement. While driving down Muwe way between Elita Park and Ndlovini, Mr. Kwabe heard a gunshot. He was shocked when he heard the gunshot and asked Mr. Mgeni what he had done. Mr. Mgeni replied that he had shot the woman. He then took the first turn off into Elita Park and stopped on the side of the road. Mr. Kwabe testified that when he got out of the vehicle, he noticed that Mr. Mgeni was looking for something in the back of the vehicle. He informed Kwabe that he was looking for the cartridge case. Mr. Kwabe assisted him to look for it and found it, and they then left the car. Mr. Kwabe threw the cartridge case in a stormwater drain, and a little further away, he threw away the gloves that he had been wearing. Mr. Mgeni then took the money from the pouch. Mr. Kwabe was not certain when Mr. Mgeni removed the money from the pouch, although he thinks it was shortly after Mr. Tongo had told them where the money was. They counted the money and found that it was only 10,000 rand. They shared it between them, and Mr. Kwabe then went home. On the Sunday, Mr. Kwabe phoned Mr. Mlombo. He wanted to see Mr. Mlombo because they were short paid in that they were paid 10,000 rand instead of the 15,000 rand agreed upon. Mr. Mlombo apparently undertook to sort this out with Mr. Tongo. Mr. Mgeni returned Mr. Kwabe's firearm. Mr. Kwabe testified that he thinks he had further contact with Mr. Mlombo to find out how far Mr. Mlombo got to recover the money that was short. Mr. Kwabe assisted the police to retrieve the cartridge and one of the gloves that he had thrown away. He eventually pleaded guilty and admitted his involvement in the matter. He explained that Mr. Tongo's number does not appear on his list of contacts on his cell phone, as he deleted it after the incident. Cross-examination. During cross-examination, it soon appeared that Mr. Kwabe was a self-confessed liar. He conceded that after his arrest, he applied for bail and testified on oath in the bail application that he had an alibi defense to the charges against him. This he maintained for a period of almost 2 years before he decided to plead guilty. There are various aspects of his evidence that are unsatisfactory, but there are two that stand out and require particular scrutiny. Subheading, Mr. Mlombo's evidence. Mr. Kwabe was questioned about Mr. Mlombo's role and testified as follows. Quote, as far as you are aware, apart from Monde phoning you and giving Zola your telephone number, did Monde have anything further to do with this incident up until the Sunday? Answer, I think maybe he would have asked, have we met with a guy, something like that, so we might have communicated, I'm not sure. So he might have asked you whether you have met. Yes, sir. Yes, yes. But he was not actively involved in arranging things, giving messages, talking to you, that sort of thing. No, sir. Not at all? No. When questioned more specifically about Mr. Mlombo's role in the events, he testified as follows. What was his role in this affair? He was the one that put me in contact with Zola. Question. Yes, no, I understand that according to you, he put you in contact with Zola. Yes. Did he have any other role to play? Not that I know of. He was the link between me and Zola. Yeah, yes, sir. And then that's all he did, and then he was out of it, right? He was the link, sir. I said that's all he did. He linked you and Zola, and for the rest, he was out of it. Yes, sir. When he was asked whether he spoke to Mr. Mlombo on the Saturday, he replied that he could have spoken to them. He then testified as follows. For what purpose, sir? Maybe if Zola didn't come to confirm, you know, things like that. Question, now why would you phone him if Zola didn't come to confirm that? What does that mean? Why would you do that? No answer. I'm waiting for a reply. I don't know, sir. Was Monde Mlombo not deeply involved in what happened that Saturday when the accused and his wife were hijacked? The answer, deeply involved would be a strong word, sir, because he was only the contact between me and Zola. He wasn't even at the meeting, sir. There was no reason for him to discuss this matter with you at all on the Saturday afternoon and evening. Is that what you are saying? The only time I recall discussing the job was the Friday with Monde. With this attitude, he persisted. Even when he was confronted with the audio recordings of a phone call from Mr. Mlombo to him, in which Mr. Mlombo told him, it's the thing we were talking about, it must happen today, he replied that he did not recall that call and reiterated that Mlombo was nothing more than a link. He could, however, not explain why, if Mr. Mlombo was merely a link, there were so many calls made between him and Mr. Mlombo and between Mr. Mlombo and Mr. Tongo during the course of the Saturday. There can be no question that Mr. Kwabe was at all times aware of the role that Mr. Mlombo was playing, particularly if one has regard to the contents of the audio recordings of the telephone conversations and the number of calls and attempted calls made by Mr. Mlombo on the Saturday night to Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Tongo. Next subheading, the shooting of the deceased. Mr. Kwabe testified that Mr. Mgeni shot the deceased while he was sitting in the left front passenger seat with a firearm in his left hand, pointing at the deceased who was sitting on the back seat. He had his right shoulder to the back and his left shoulder was turned with a firearm pointing at the deceased. Dr. Verster, who testified on behalf of the state, testified that the single shot that killed the deceased was an angled contact shot. She further testified that the shot would immediately have rendered the deceased paralyzed. It is clear from the photographs of the deceased's position after the attack that she was very close to the backrest of the rear seat. According to Dr. Verster, the deceased's left hand would have been against or very close to her chest when the shot was fired. In fact, the state's ballistic expert, Warrant Officer Engelbrecht, conceded that it would not have been possible for Mr. Mgeni to have shot the deceased from the position in which he claimed he was. Mr. Kwabe's explanation as to how the deceased was shot also does not explain the marks of a right hand found on the left lower leg by Dr. Verster. Mr. Kwabe's evidence as to how this incident took place and how Mr. Mgeni shot the deceased can, with reference of the objective facts, not be correct. I say this for the following reasons. On the state's case, Mr. Mgeni could not have shot the deceased while he was seated on the left front passenger seat. His explanation does not cater for the marks on the deceased's left lower leg. Dr. Verster's evidence is that these bruises were caused by fingertips and were sustained before she died. She would have been immediately paralyzed after the shot and would have died virtually instantly. These marks undoubtedly indicate some form of struggle. This is irreconcilable with Mr. Kwabe's evidence. Primer residue was found on the web of the glove that Mr. Kwabe wore between the thumb and the forefinger. Although, according to the evidence of Lieutenant Colonel Mlabateki, this could have been the result of Mr. Kwabe being in close proximity of where the shot was fired. It must, however, be borne in mind that primer residue was found where one would normally expect to find it if a firearm was fired by a person holding the firearm in that hand. It is common course that glove marks corresponding with Mr. Kwabe's type of glove was found on the outside of the left rear door by a fingerprint expert. Mr. Kwabe tried to explain this by stating that it might have happened when he opened the door to look for the cartridge case, but hereafter his evidence disintegrated into a garbled mess. According to Lieutenant Colonel Mlabateki's evidence, primer residue can be transferred from, for instance, a glove contaminated with primer residue to surfaces coming into contact with a glove. In this regard, it is important to note that primer residue was found to be present on the inside handle area of the driver's door. No primer residue was found to be present in the area around the left front passenger seat where Mr. Mgeni was supposed to have been sitting. There are other questionable aspects of Mr. Kwabe's evidence. According to the state case, Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Mgeni were to shoot and kill the deceased after they had dropped off the accused. Yes, after they had dropped off the accused, they did not go to the nearby bushy areas, but instead drove back into the residential area down Mew Way, which was one of the major roads in that area, in the direction of the N2. When Mr. Kwabe was questioned about this and asked where they were going to, he stated that they were going to no specific place. He could also not give a reason as to why they decided to drive back into the residential area if they knew that they now had to kill the deceased. This evidence should be looked at carefully against the reference to a fifth person in Mr. Mbolombo's telephone conversation with Mr. Tongo on the Saturday evening. Mr. Kwabe's evidence is, of course, contradicted by the evidence of both Mr. Mlombo and Mr. Tongo, as far as their discussions on the Friday evening are concerned. I have dealt with these aspects, and I'm not going to repeat them. Mr. Kwabe also contradicted Mr. Tongo's evidence that he was not aware that the person had to be killed was the accused wife, but the accused business partner who would be arriving on the Saturday. Mr. Kwabe persisted that when Mr. Tongo phoned him on the Friday night, he told him that there was a husband who wanted his wife killed. Mr. Kwabe also testified that the 15,000 rand remuneration was a price determined by Mr. Mgeni and not Mr. Tongo, as he stated in his evidence. I now come to the evidence of Monde Mlombo. Mr. Mlombo was also an accomplice witness, and he was warned in terms of Section 204 of the Criminal Procedure Act in respect of all five charges. Mr. Mlombo testified that Mr. Tongo telephoned him at his workplace on the afternoon of the 12th of November, and he informed him that he was on his way to the hotel where he worked. Upon his arrival, Mr. Tongo asked him whether he knew of anybody who was a hitman. They then moved outside the lobby of the Protea Hotel. Mr. Mlombo told him that he did not socialize with criminals. However, he said that he would make inquiries from a person whom he called Abongile. It is common cause that Abongile is a reference to Mr. Kwabe. Mr. Mlombo and Mr. Kwabe had previously worked together on a project called the Pride of Table Mountain. They last had contact in 2006, but purely by chance, on the 1st of November 2010, they met at Monwabizi Beach. On that occasion, Mr. Kwabe was apparently in the company of people who looked like criminals. During the course of the conversation, Mr. Kwabe asked him, Mr. Mlombo, whether he had any people who were bothering him or worrying him, and that he had, if he had, he must just phone Mr. Kwabe. They exchanged phone numbers. Shortly thereafter, Mr. Mbolombo's son fell ill, and he approached Mr. Kwabe to obtain a bullet from him in order to use the powder thereof on the advice of a traditional healer. Mr. Mbolombo explained that because he was supplied with this bullet by Mr. Kwabe, that was the reason why he thought he could approach Mr. Kwabe to be the hitman. Mr. Mlombo stated that he told Mr. Kwabe that there is this person called Zola, and he told him about the job and the nature thereof. He told Mr. Kwabe that he knew Mr. Tongo and that Mr. Tongo would pay 15,000 rand for the job. Mr. Kwabe, at one stage during the conversation, indicated that they should not discuss the matter on the phone, but that they should rather meet. According to Mr. Mlombo, Mr. Kwabe indicated that he would have no problem to do the job. After Mr. Tongo had left, Mr. Mlombo telephoned Mr. Kwabe in order to reassure him that he knew Mr. Tongo and that he could be trusted. Mr. Mlombo testified that he received a call from Mr. Tongo on the morning of the 13th of November 2010, who requested that he accompany him to a meeting with Mr. Kwabe in order to discuss, quote, how to go about in doing this, end quote. Mr. Mlombo contacted Mr. Kwabe and informed him that Mr. Tongo would be coming to Khayelitsha. Mr. Mlombo said that he waited for Mr. Tongo to meet him at his home in Khayelitsha. Mr. Tongo was aware that Mr. Mlombo's shift at the Protea Hotel started at 3 o'clock. Mr. Tongo did not arrive at Mr. Mlombo, and Mr. Mlombo went back to the taxi rank at site C, but shortly after his arrival there, Mr. Tongo contacted him and said that he was on his way. After Mr. Tongo arrived, Mr. Mlombo got into Tongo's vehicle. Tongo gave him a lift to work. In the vehicle, Mr. Mlombo inquired from Mr. Tongo why he was looking for a hitman. Mr. Tongo informed him that there was a married couple and that the husband wants the woman to be killed. Mr. Mlombo then wanted to know which woman and how he had met these people. Mr. Tongo informed him that he had met the people at the airport and, quote, it is the man who wants his wife to be killed, end quote. Mr. Mlombo testified that while he and Mr. Tongo were driving towards Mr. Mlombo's work, Mr. Tonga received a phone call and then said, here is the gentleman that we are talking about, the man who wants his wife to be killed. It's a quote from here to killed. Mr. Tonga then explained on the phone, and all Mr. Mlambo could hear was Mr. Tonga saying, I'm coming, I'm coming. Mr. Tonga thereupon put his phone down and said that the gentleman did not trust him. Mr. Tonga then informed him that he had to go and take the accused to change dollars into rands so that he could pay the killers. He added that the accused did not want to go to a, quote, legitimate place where the dollars are being changed for rands because he, the accused, did not want to be charged tax. Mr. Tonga also informed Mr. Mlambo that the couple was from overseas and that it was not the first time that the accused had done this, in inverted commas, that he had been in South Africa before, done this, in inverted commas, before, and he wants to do it again, but it should appear to be a fake hijacking. Upon arrival at the Protea Hotel, Mr. Tongo said to Mr. Mlambo that he had to rush to Khayelitsha to meet Mr. Kwabe. During his evidence in chief, Mr. Mlambo described his role as follows. Quote, to make sure that Zola and Abongile meet and to see to it that this thing happens, end quote. Later he elaborated by stating that the reason why he had further telephonic contact with Mr. Kwabe was to get things into order, to make sure that things go according to how they are planned. Mr. Mlambo testified that he knew that the persons involved was a married couple and that Mr. Tonga was going to drive them to a restaurant in Somerset West where they would have dinner. Mr. Kwabe telephoned Mr. Mlambo at approximately 1900 hours that evening and informed him that he was looking for Mr. Tonga, but that Mr. Tonga's phone was switched off. Mr. Mlambo eventually got hold of Mr. Tonga and informed him that, quote, these guys are looking for gloves, end quote. He explained that this related to an earlier request from Mr. Kwabe on the Saturday morning to inform him that they wanted gloves so as not to leave any fingerprints behind. Mr. Mlambo stated that when he heard that the person who had mandated this killing was going to pay 15,000 rand, he indicated that he would have to pay for all his effort and also have to be paid for all his effort in this matter, even if it was 5,000 rand. There was, however, no firm agreement on the amount to be paid. Mr. Mlambo testified that during a telephone conversation on the Saturday afternoon with Mr. Tonga, Mr. Tonga informed him that he was going to place the money in the cubbyhole of the vehicle. Mr. Mlambo stated that Mr. Tonga was supposed to have met with Mr. Kwabe to give him the money, but that they could not meet. Mr. Mlambo also inquired from Mr. Tonga during the same telephone discussion whether he managed to get the gloves that they earlier spoke about. Mr. Mlambo testified that it was after this conversation with Mr. Tonga that Mr. Kwabe telephoned him looking for Mr. Tonga and informed him that they were supposed to meet. When Mr. Mlambo finally got hold of Mr. Tonga, Mr. Tonga informed him that his phone was switched off because he was, quote, with the people, in brackets, the Dewanis, at a table, end quote, and that that was the reason why he could not answer his phone. Shortly thereafter, Mr. Mlambo received a phone call from Mr. Tonga, who informed him that they were leaving the restaurant and that they were going to Guguletu. According to Mr. Mlambo, he did not know exactly where in Guguletu this would happen, only that it would happen in Guguletu. Mr. Mlambo testified that Mr. Kwabe informed him that As the people were coming to Guguletu, they will take the vehicle and then go to Kailicha. They will then drop off Mr. Tonga as well as the husband, and then they will drive on with the wife. Mr. Kwabe also informed Mr. Mlombo that they were going to stop the people, take the vehicle, and then go to Kailisha. Mr. Mlombo testified that he did not know exactly where in Kailisha they were going to do this, only that it was going to take place in Kailisha, and that they were going to leave the vehicle there and thereafter wash the vehicle. On Sunday, 14 November 2010, Mr. Mlombo was at home and tried to call Mr. Tonga but could not get hold of him. Mr. Mlombo said Mr. Kwabe arrived at his home on the Sunday morning at about 10 o'clock and informed him that the money that Mr. Tonga gave him was short by 5,000 rand. Mr. Mlombo testified that at that stage Mr. Kwabe was so angry that he did not ask Mr. Kwabe about whether he, Mr. Mlombo, would be paid. Mr. Kwabe wanted to know where Mr. Tonga was, and Mr. Mlombo informed him that he did not know. Mr. Mlombo then asked Mr. Kwabe what had happened, and Mr. Kwabe told him that he should not ask a lot of things, and whether he did not see on TV what had happened. Mr. Kwabe also requested Mr. Mlombo to inform Mr. Tonga that Mr. Kwabe wanted his additional 5,000 rand. On his arrival at work on the 15th of November 2010, Mr. Mlombo read about the incident in the newspaper. He then realized that they had really killed the woman. On Wednesday, 17 November 2010, Mr. Mlombo was contacted by Mr. Tonga, who informed him that he was phoning from his girlfriend's telephone. Mr. Tonga informed him that the police contacted him about the shooting incident, that he didn't tell them the truth, and that he just told the police that he does not know anything. Mr. Mlombo then informed him that Mr. Kwabe was looking for him. Mr. Tonga then warned him, Mr. Mlombo, to get away from those guys, in inverted commas, as they were very dangerous. Mr. Mlombo was arrested on the 18th of November 2010. He made a warning statement to Lieutenant Colonel Barkhuizen. Thereafter, he was interviewed and he was advised that police were going to take down a statement in terms of Section 204 of the Criminal Procedure Act. This statement was made on the 19th of November 2010, again to Lieutenant Colonel Barkhuizen. Mr. Mlombo was released after he had made these two statements. At the beginning of his evidence, Mr. Mlombo admitted that he had lied in his warning statement and in his statement to the police in terms of Section 204 of the Criminal Procedure Act. He also admitted that he had lied during his evidence in the Mngeni trial. He, however, testified that his lies were limited to downplaying the extent of his involvement in this matter. Mr. Mlombo testified that the provisions of Section 204 were not only explained to him on two occasions, but that he understood what they meant. Shortly before the commencement of this trial, Mr. Mlombo made yet another statement correcting certain errors and or lies in his previous statement. He stated that after a lengthy consultation with the prosecution team and after having been given the opportunity to view the CCTV footage and listen to the audio recordings, he realized that he could no longer hide and had to open up and be honest. Before Mr. Mlombo proceeded with his evidence, he delivered a pre-prepared speech, which from the record appears to be very similar to a similarly emotive speech which he gave to the court in the Mngeni trial before blatantly lying about material aspects. Those aspects about which he lied had nothing to do with hiding his involvement in the matter. Be that as it may, Mr. Mlombo's evidence unraveled during cross-examination. He started to contradict himself on each and every material aspect of his earlier evidence. I do not intend to deal with all these contradictions. Mr. Mlombo is a self-confessed liar. He admitted in court that he lied when he posed to his warning statement on the 18th of November. He lied when he deposed to his 204 statement on the 19th of November 2010. He lied when he testified before Justice Henney in the Mgeni matter, and he also admitted that he had concealed his own involvement and knowledge on those previous occasions since he was fearful of what the repercussions would be. As his evidence progressed, it became more and more clear that he was deeply involved in this entire incident and played a very important role. I mention but one example. Mr. Mlombo testified that the accused testified Mr. Tongo in his presence shortly before 3 p.m. on the Saturday afternoon on their way to the Protea Hotel. Mr. Tongo told him that he had to take the accused to exchange dollars into rands in order to be able to pay the killers. It is, however, common cause that no such telephone call ever took place. It is further common cause that by that time, Mr. Tongo had already taken the accused to exchange the money. Mr. Mlombo testified about a further call which was supposed to have taken place between him and Mr. Tongo at 19 hours 30 on the Saturday evening, when Mr. Tongo explained to him that the reason why he could not answer his phone was because he was, quote, sitting at the table with a couple, end quote. Similarly, it is common cause that no such call between Mr. Tongo and Mr. Mlombo ever took place, and that Mr. Tongo was never inside the restaurant with the accused and the deceased. In addition, there are stark contradictions between the evidence of Mr. Mlombo, Mr. Tongo, and Mr. Kwabe on all material aspects. Mr. Mopp argued that Mr. Mlombo, in quote, an ironic twist, end quote, moved from protecting himself at all costs to asserting that he played a leading role in the events of the 12th and 13th of November 2010. This is hardly an ironic twist. His leading role is supported by clear objective facts such as the phone records and the audio recordings. I cannot agree with Mr. Mopp's argument that the incentive for Mr. Mlombo to now actively involve himself in communicating with Mr. Tongo and Mr. Kwabe is the prospect of receiving 5,000 rand payment. This submission has only to be made to be rejected. To summarize, Mr. Tongo, who was the only witness who could link the accused to the conspiracy, gave evidence to the court which is so improbable and contains so many mistakes, lies, and inconsistency that one simply cannot know where the lies end and where the truth begins. I accept that at this stage of the proceedings, the credibility of a witness plays a limited role, but in my view, the evidence of these witnesses is so replete with fundamental contradictions on the key components of the state case that I can all but ignore it. In making this finding, I take into account that all three witnesses, Mr. Tongo, Mr. Mlombo, and Mr. Kwabe, are intelligent people, and therefore more than capable of attempting to twist their version to implicate the accused. Mr. Tongo obtained grade 12 at the Malibu High School in Blue Downs. Thereafter, he became an insurance consultant. Then he became a VIP taxi driver with Platinum Escapes and then started his own shuttle service in 2010. Mr. Mlombo matriculated from the Modderdam High School. Thereafter, he was employed until 2000 by the Pride of Table Mountain. He thereafter did a two-year course as an assistant educational officer presented by the Department of Environmental Affairs. He thereafter worked as a security guard and since 2007 was working at the Protea Hotel, where he was dismissed as a result of his involvement in this matter. Mr. Kwabe attended Oude Moorland School and obtained an N2 in electrical engineering in 2003 at the Western Province Technical College in Pinelands. After his studies, he was formally employed until 2010 inter alia as an assessor in an insurance company, and thereafter assisted his mother. These men are not typical of the criminal elements which one encounters in these courts. Each one of them impressed me as intelligent and bright, but at the same time calculated. They may have been amateurs in arranging a hit on a person's life, but I do not believe that any one of them would be so stupid as to take part in this crime for just a few thousand rand. On Mr. Tongo's own saying, he earned between 30 and 40,000 rand per month. Mr. Malombo had a job. Mr. Kwabe was formerly employed until April 2010 and thereafter assisted his mother in her business. The inference is inescapable that these three gentlemen anticipated that there would be much more in this for them than the 15,000 rand which they testified about. Mr. Mopp argued that but for the tragic consequences of this case, the conduct of the three conspirators would have been comical. He said, I must look at the evidence of Mr. Tongo and Mr. Kwabe and Mr. Malombo in the light that they are not the A-team of hijackers. I, however, cannot ignore the fact that these are three intelligent men who testified, and each one of them was a self-confessed liar who continued lying to this court. On the question of whether I should grant Mr. Malombo indemnity from prosecution, I think I have said enough about his evidence to justify a refusal to grant him indemnity. I therefore refuse to grant him indemnity. As pointed out above, Mr. Tongo is a single witness who is also an accomplice witness. I have noted earlier that in these circumstances, the court must look for corroboration of his evidence. On the cases referred to, it is clear that such corroboration must be corroboration implicating the accused. Mr. Mopp attempted to persuade me that I could find corroboration in the circumstantial evidence. The evidence, such as it is, he was constrained to concede, does however not implicate the accused. Regrettably, there are many unanswered questions about what happened on this fateful night. I realize there is strong public opinion that the accused should be placed on his defense. I take note of that. I have heard the plight of the Hindocha family, that they would like answers to the question. I have, however, taken an oath of office to uphold the rule of law and to administer justice without fear, favor, or prejudice. That I cannot do if I permit public opinion to influence my application of the law. If any court permitted public opinion or emotion to influence their judgments, it would lead to anarchy. I am obliged to follow the established legal principles regarding the discharge at the close of the state case. In the light of the analysis of the state case, there is no evidence upon which a reasonable court, acting carefully, can convict the accused, and I am, as I said, obliged to follow established legal principles regarding a discharge. The law is clear. The evidence of the accused, if he does not incriminate himself, can never strengthen the state's case. Even if the accused should enter the witness stand and is a wholly unsatisfactory witness, I will still be left with a weak state case which cannot, on any basis, pass legal muster. At this stage of the proceedings, I have a discretion as to whether or not to grant the application in terms of section 174. This is a discretion which must self-evidently be exercised judicially. Having regard to the fact that I have already found that there is insufficient evidence upon which a reasonable court, acting carefully, might convict, the only possible reason at this stage for me refusing the application can be the hope that the accused will implicate himself during his evidence. To do so will be a manifest misdirection. See State versus Leboxer. Mr. Mopp argued that the evidence of Sergeant Mellett Warrant Officers Stefanis, Captain Lutchman, and Captain Hendrickser, who all testified that the accused informed them that the deceased wanted to see the nightlife in the township and that it was at her request they drove back into Guguletu. He argued that this shows that Mr. Tongo did not take the detour into Guguletu of his own accord. This submission cannot be sustained. The entire hijacking and killing was planned to take place in Khayelitsha. But even if he is right, the issues raised by Mr. Mopp can only be answered in favor of the state if the accused incriminates himself. The same applies to Mr. Mopp's submissions regarding the accused's version that he gave the Hindocha family about the deceased killing. These statements do not bolster the state case. On the contrary, without the accused taking the witness stand and incriminating himself, they take the matter no further. This case, in my view, falls squarely within the ambit of the following dictum of Nugent A.J. in State versus Lebaxa, which for the sake of completeness, I repeat. Clearly, a person ought not to be prosecuted in the absence of a minimum of evidence upon which he might be convicted, merely in the expectation that at some stage he might incriminate himself. That is recognized by the common law principle that there should be, quote, reasonable and probable, end quote, cause to believe that the accused is guilty of an offense before a prosecution is initiated. And the constitutional protection afforded to dignity and personal freedom, bracket sections 10 and section 12, seems to reinforce it. It ought to follow that if a prosecution is not to be commenced without that minimum of evidence, so too it should cease when the evidence finally falls below that threshold. In my view, the evidence presented in this case falls far below this threshold. In the circumstances, I make the following order. The application in terms of Section 174 of the Criminal Procedure Act is granted. The accused is found not guilty on this charge, and Mr. Mlombo is not granted indemnity from prosecution. Court will adjourn. All right.